as we come together to be the people of God. And Kathy and I are going to rely on your energy to help handle our nervousness. And we're going to begin with prayer. Would you join us in prayer? God, you create us in your image. That image is always with us. It can never be wiped out. It can never be overcome with sickness, for it's your image in each one of us. And that image is always life-giving, no matter what we are experiencing externally and internally. Thank you for giving us your spirit as Kathy shares her journey of being involved in something that comes to anyone without any kind of sense that this is going to happen. And your spirit gets us through. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Kathy is a member of Zion. And she's been with this illness how many years?
It started in 2007. And the beginning of 2008, I was on dialysis. It's called end-stage renal disease. And it came as a shock. I was perfectly fine. I thought I had the flu. And I went for my yearly physical. And lo and behold, the blood work showed that I had kidney failure. It was pretty rapid. Some people can live a long time before going on dialysis. For me, it was pretty fast. I started out on hemodialysis, as does almost everybody. I switched to peritoneal dialysis in 2008, which is through your abdomen, and you're able to do your dialysis at home every day, every night, 9 hours a night. And although that sounds pretty gruesome, it actually becomes like brushing your teeth. You hook up to a machine. Your body is cleansed through the night. You learn to sleep being stuck to a machine. But
what do you call your machine?
I call her Beatrice the Beast, because when you put a name to her, you can talk to her, and you can be angry, and you can whine, and you can say, I don't want to do this anymore. But the big thing was, it was my lifeline. It wasn't long before I had no kidney function at all, so therefore any poisons in my body would stay there without dialysis.
What was your reaction when you first heard this designation that you now have this condition?
I was so, well, first I went through a rage. You know, they don't let you drive if you're drunk. But when you get a diagnosis like that at a doctor's office, they let you get in the car and drive home. I have no recollection of getting home other than the fact that I was in a rage. And then I went from that to denial that this was all a mistake and that God was going to come down and a miracle was going to happen and I was going to be well. I had a great life. My husband was a crime scene analyst. And worked for the state police, which is the dark side of life. But I worked in the tourism industry, which is the fun side of life. And I thought I would never stop working because it was so fun. And all of a sudden, I had this thing that had just happened out of the blue. So I went through the, you know, a miracle's going to happen in denial. I didn't want to talk about it. I didn't want to know about it. I didn't want any part of the disease at all. And then I got really ill and was air-vac'd to Las Vegas. Was in ICU for quite a while and came home and said to God, I'm done. You know what? I just can't do this anymore. And once I said that, this moment is where you really know that faith and God never ever leaves you. Because when I vocalized, I'm done. If it's time for me to go, then take me. Because I am done with this. And it was like a weight lifted off of me in that moment. And I started to get better, not physically, but inside. It was easier. It was like, this is okay. I'm going to be okay in that God is with me and he walks with us when you get to these moments. You don't have to know he's there. It's like being on a cliff and stepping off, as Linda would know. And knowing that you're not going to crash, that something is going to hold you up. And it was a scary time, but a time when I came to the realization that I couldn't drive the bus. God drives the bus. He has his plan. He knows where you're going, even though you don't. And you can sit in the back and backseat drive. It's okay. And it's okay to be angry, and it's okay to talk to him. But he still got his plan, and that's the plan that you have for your life. And once you get to that point, you actually feel the faith that he has in you to move on. And so I did dialysis for the next 4 years. And
you moved here to
we Europe. Moved to we were in Arizona when I was diagnosed. And from the point of my giving up to God and saying, I'm done, do with me as you will, I prayed for a transplant, because transplants are all, they give you a much more normal life, a much more free life. But after praying for a very long time, I realized that I was still trying to set the plan for God as to what was going to happen with me. And I started to pray that I would accept God's plan for me, whatever that would be. And lo and behold, I got a transplant. And you all know Sue, who just bravely stepped forward without a blink of an eye and went through all the testing. We were almost a perfect match. And of course, in the grand scheme of things, receiving a kidney from a live donor is almost 100% yeah. successful. The failure rate is 1%. So never in my wildest dreams did I ever fathom that I wasn't going to get up and walk out of that hospital, 5 to 7 days after the transplant. So everybody went into this with just a positive and good thing, because the things that happened afterwards were not nice and not pleasant. But all along through that whole process, the kidney worked in the beginning, but within 12 hours, it was no longer working.
It shut down.
My body shut it down. So all along, I was in ICU for weeks, and I never questioned why at that time. For some strange reason, I knew that I was going to get through this, although everybody else thought I wasn't, and, everybody was sure that I was done. But God apparently was not done with me. So I came home and then decided that I would not deal with the rejection until I was healthy enough to emotionally deal with it. So putting that aside, I then developed sepsis throughout my entire body and was
rushed. Which is another threatening.
Right. And I was rushed back to the hospital and then back to Harrisburg, where they had to go back in and remove the kidney and clean me out and do all the ugly medical stuff that they do to you when you're in the hospital. But through all of that, I will say that I never felt like I was alone. I remember feeling a lot of anger that was building up, that was like, why does this happen? But then it would die down and I would be sustained with the strength of God, telling me, that things were going to be okay. So after months of hemodialysis again. I went back on my peritoneal dialysis, and things became pretty good again. And I developed strength and moved forward, and knowing that at some point I was going to have to deal with the rejection and the emotional end of that, which for some reason God kind of carried me through that. I had some anger, more over the fact that Sue had given up a healthy kidney and my body had failed me and rejected it. And the fact that somebody else might have gotten that kidney and been better. And I questioned that with God and did my little complaining thing about, you know, I know I'm not going to know your plan, but somehow give me the strength to continue forward through this and be somebody that can help somebody else. Throughout all of this, through all of my dialysis, I had joined the partnership program, which is called Patient Partnership, where you work with other patients that are just coming on to dialysis. And from that, I actually took more than I could give. Because the strength that you see in other people that are chronically ill is beyond belief. And it doesn't matter whether it's a kidney disease or, you know, any other chronically ill person goes through all of these same emotions and same trials and tribulations. But the one thing that I've been blessed with, first of all, I have a really strong family and a really great husband and children that support me and are always there for me. But even putting that aside, God is inside of us, and we just have to believe that if we get to that cliff and we step out, He will carry you. And one of my mantras has always been footprints in the sand. And I truly believe that whomever wrote that was going through or had been through a crisis, because we all play at being Christians, and I did before this. But to really believe that there is only one set of footprints in certain spots of your life is absolutely the truth. There are times when you can't walk and you can't move forward without God inside of you, carrying you. So this last month, I developed an infection in my catheter site.
She was going exercising.
Oh, I've been back to the gym. I was so excited. And, you know, I had gotten we call them our numbers, but it's the blood numbers. And there are all sorts of measures about what you eat and what you can't eat and what, because you don't have a filter for certain things in your blood. So I had got all of my numbers up, and there was like this big party at the dialysis center because Kathy had finally reached 4 in the protein levels. And so for 2 days I was on this high, and then I woke up with this sharp pain in my side to the point that it was worse than when they took the kidney out. So I immediately went into the doctors, and I had a tunnel infection, which is an infection that cannot be treated by oral antibiotics or by a flush. They put me on a flush system, which is putting supersonic antibiotics into your peritoneal cavity to prevent the tunnel infection to not go into the peritoneal, because that's deadly. So they did that, and in the meantime, I got a little bit better, and they thought maybe they had got it, but they didn't. And so I was rushed into surgery, and they removed my catheter and cleaned out my peritoneal. And
now this just happened recently.
Yeah,
so here
this is 2 weeks ago,
tonight.
3 weeks ago. And they put in a neck catheter, which I have, and put me back on hemodialysis, which is just, if you know anybody on hemodialysis, you have to give them just kudos for sticking with it, because it is a brutal process, which is not so much uncomfortable as it just beats your body up. But it is a lifeline. It keeps you alive. And the hopes are that at some point they will be able to reinsert my peritoneal catheter, and I will be able to go back with Beatrice, who sits on my bureau, and I talk to her about, I really miss you. But this time, when the infection happened, I was very angry. I couldn't understand why God would let me have this great high and then pull it out from under me. And so I just had this really ugly conversation with God and what I thought. And at that moment, I thought, whoa, wait a minute. You know, this is about faith, and this is about God being there. And he obviously was there, because I didn't die from the infection, which people do. And, you know, I still have so many blessings. So at that moment when I was complaining, it was like God said to me, it's okay for you to be mad. It's okay for you to be angry. It's okay for you to talk back and be a backseat driver. But you have to remember that I am always with you. And even though I don't see a white-haired man with a long flowing beard, and even though I don't hear words like you're hearing me, I feel the presence and the faith that he gives me. And that is so powerful that it overcomes that human element and puts you on a spiritual plane, so that you don't lose, you know, even though your body may not be the best at this time, your spirit and your soul and all of your innards are so much more powerful and healthy that you still are able to give. Even though, you know, when I was first diagnosed, you know, we had a five-year plan, what was going to be, what our life was going to be like in 5 years from now. And, you know, even throughout the beginning of that, you know, my plan was, you know, we were going to move and we were going to travel and we were going to do all these wonderful things. But once you go through a chronic illness or you experience a crisis like this, you don't need to have that five-year plan. You just have to have faith that you will have, that God has a plan, and he will carry you through that plan the best way possible. Our bodies break, but our souls don't, and our spirits are always
healthy.
Healthy. And you just have to know that you have to open it up to hear it. So.
And we're going to close with Footprints in the Sand. It will be projected. Let us read it together. Footprints in the Sand.
One night I dreamed I was walking along the beach with the Lord. Many scenes from my life flashed across the sky. In each scene, I noticed footprints in the sand. Sometimes there were two sets of footprints. Other times there were one set of footprints. This bothered me because I noticed that during the low periods of my life, when I was suffering from anguish, sorrow, or defeat, I could see only one set of footprints. So I said to the Lord, you promised me, Lord, that if I followed you, you would walk with me always. But I have noticed that during the most trying periods of my life, there have only been one set of footprints in the sand. Why, when I needed you most, you have not been there for me? The Lord replied, the times when you have seen only one set of footprints is when I carried you.
Thank you so much, Kathy.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Kathy is willing to stay 10 minutes after the service if you want to come up here and you have any concerns. This has also been audio taped, and if you would like a copy of her witnessing, call the church office and you can get a copy.